Hello, everyone. Good evening. I hope everyone's excited. I'm Pete Fung. On behalf of the lecture committee, I'd like to welcome everyone to the first lecture of the academic year. Before we jump into tonight's programming, I just want to spend a few minutes, give a sort of brief introduction to the lecture series, as some of you may be new to the school. So the DEE lecture series is a cross-year, cross-discipline forum that runs throughout the year. Through bringing in different perspectives, our aim has always been to create a space for critical debates and thinking in the vicinity of design, art, and architecture, especially and more importantly, how these practices relate to the current and ongoing social discourse. Second year in the running now, we are very excited about the things that we have planned for the year. We'll continue to play with the format of lectures, and we're excited to say that we are partnering with a number of departments and organizations in and outside of the school to bring you fantastic speakers and events. To give you a bit of a sneak peek, in October 27th, we are working with the Avena at the graduation show, where we'll bring you a panel moderated by Saskia, the new head of Critical Inquiry Lab, together with a number of designers from various times of Design Academy. We'll be looking at the past, present, and future of Design Academy, as well as design's past, present, and future. But back to today, I feel extremely fortunate or privileged to be able to introduce the speaker for tonight. 2 years ago, I met Bas and Daniela in a conference in Denmark, and listening to them talking about their work inspired me to apply to the master program here. Tonight, it had definitely helped come full circle that I'm organizing the lecture for them and being able to share the experience with you. In addition to Bas and Danielle, we are also joined by Avinash from Quicksand, one of the longtime collaborators, which I also learned earlier that you're alumni from Design Academy.
No? You like playing later. I'll explain.
Okay, yeah. I'll let you do that. I'll let them introduce themselves in a little bit. But this evening will be divided into three parts. First, Bas and Danielle is going to give an overall view of the readership. So we'll unpack a little bit of the knowledge generated and the goal achieved over the past 8 years. Avinash is going to give a little bit of the readership's field trip and the collaboration in India. And then at the end, both will be joined to take some questions from the audience moderated by Danielle. So without further ado, please join me to welcome Bas and Danielle on stage. Thank you.
Welcome, everyone. It's great to see so many here. I hardly can see you, but it's a full house. That's really amazing, I think. Shall I do the slides? There needs to be a switch somewhere in the back. Oh, it already happened. So it's a very special evening for me and Daniela, because we've been working here at Design Academy Eindhoven for about 8 years on a very special project for the Academy, but also for us personally. So we're very honored to be here, and we're kind of amazed, I think, that after these 8 years, we are here in this position on this stage. And we'll tell you why. But I think first, perhaps we should introduce ourselves, because I'm aware that not all of you have been in that eight-year journey that we have done here tonight. We have some guests who have been, and you can talk to them later during the drinks and check if they actually will be, if they agree with what we have talked about this evening. My name is Bas Rijmakers. I run a design research agency called Standby, and this agency has two studios in Amsterdam and London. I run it together with Keke van Dijk, co-founder, and my partner. And we do this for since 2003. And this Design Academy has been kind of a part of that. Standby came a bit in the Design Academy, and Design Academy came quite a bit in Standby as well. We do design research, which basically means that we use design methods to do research. And we do that to help our clients to achieve some kind of transformation. They want to change something in their organization or on their services or maybe even in the world. Our topics range from how people collaborate digitally in teams to climate change and a lot of other things as well. You want to introduce yourself as well, Daniela?
Okay. again. I started 10 years ago at the Design Academy, actually starting with the Design Debates program at the time. It was even called White Lady Lectures. As some of you know, this building was at that time called the White Lady Building. I started as a journalist within Design Academy, and I was the sort of accepted weirdo outside of the design bubble. I started last year running a readership on journalism, and now I'm getting the sort of design atmosphere within journalism. So I think I'm in between, and I think I learned that mostly by doing a lot of design research projects that we fill you in about today.
Great. So this is us, basically, Daniela and me. I found this picture in the huge archive on my computer on Design Academy Eindhoven. And this is how we started the readership of strategic creativity. It's a little bit more than 8 years ago. We're wearing these suits because we were really pioneers at that time, and I think we kind of remained pioneers for the full 8 years, because it also fits us as people, I think, to be pioneers. Because design research, in particular academic design research, didn't really exist at Design Academy Eindhoven until that time. Maybe some of you are not really aware it exists at this moment, but it does. The readership is basically a group of researchers that actually do research with alumni of Design Academy Eindhoven on topics that kind of relate to society in some way or another. And we bring actually also students in that research. So some of you are here tonight as well, and we're very happy that you joined us on that journey in times. So there were, during that period, two readerships. The other readership is run by David Hamers. It's called Traces and Places. And David and Daniela and myself, and also later Paolo Patelli, the associates reader from David's readership, we kind of formed the core of design research. And from there, a lot of things started to grow that we want to talk a bit to you about. The first thing I want to mention is kind of how it started to grow, which is basically because Design Academy Eindhoven about 9 years ago was asked to set up a big national research program together with the three technical universities in the Netherlands and some 60 partners, something like that. So that was a bit daunting in the beginning. Also because we didn't have that working relationship with the technical universities. They, of course, also do research, but in a quite different way than we are used doing research here. But the Ministry of Education and Culture actually, and sciences, demanded that we worked together. That is, demanded. They kind of twisted their arm by offering a lot of money, which is an interesting way of twisting someone's arm. And they put us in a room in kind of on the 20th floor in the ministry in The Hague, and they said, okay, all you professors, and we weren't professor, but we were invited as well, together with Jolanda Heesemans, who's here too. You figure out how you can set up a four-year research program that is going to help the Dutch knowledge economy to become more creative. Because they had understood that actually, if you are a knowledge economy, you can only survive if you are much more creative, actually, and not just follow, for instance, what the technical people or the chemistry people or the agriculture people come up with, the engineers, you could say. So that's what we fleshed out. The program was called CRISP. And that's that program really got the readership going. So what did we do, Daniela, in that program?
It might be good to explain. CRISP stands for Creative Research Scientific Program, which was a collaboration with, as you mentioned, three universities and a lot of partners. And that's not easy for an institute that actually doesn't have an infrastructure. So as Bas mentioned, we were pioneering setting up sort of a structure, but we even didn't know how to hire in researchers and how to execute that. But we managed over the past 8 years, I think we run executed over 15 research projects. We produced over 15 books as well. Some of them we will explain later on. We published around 20 academic papers. We hired in a lot of people, alumni from the Design Academy, to become a research associate. And these people were part-time employed in the readership, doing these kind of research projects while also running their studios. We teamed up with universities worldwide, set up an international network, created the design research minor, and that all in one day a week.
Right? 6 hours a week.
6 hours, yeah.
Yeah, so that was my side job, basically. Also, I must admit it was my first job ever, because I run my own studio and kind of run my own business, so I never had a job. I wasn't quite sure what to do if you're an employee and you have a boss and so on. But I figured that out as well along the way, so that worked.
Well, we had several bosses over the time, so.
Yeah. So let's move on to kind of what really came out of that as a kind of an overall header, I would say, and that's thinking through making. So what we really set ourselves as a task was to see kind of how can we build on the DNA of Design Academy Eindhoven and actually create some academic design research from that, and how can we connect to the international design research community, kind of starting from our own roots. That became thinking through making as a term, because the making always has been very important at Design Academy Eindhoven, as you all know. And of course, design research, in particular academic design research, the outcome is always knowledge. That's the first thing that's kind of required, that you create. But we kind of bent that in a lot of way and turned it upside down and inside out. So basically what we said was, if you make things, you also create knowledge at the same time, and you can do your thinking through the making. But also, if you have made something, the result can be communicated through what you've made, the knowledge that you've created. It doesn't need to be written knowledge. We did write as well on the site, that was important too. But basically, through reflecting on what you make, and we'll show you a list of examples in a minute, you can create knowledge. And that fitted very well with Design Academy Eindhoven. And together with David, and later also a knowledge circle, which we come to talk about, we managed to turn that into the Design Academy Eindhoven approach to design research on an academic level. So you found something on your seats, all of you, already. I think Danielle has one in her hand. This is a notebook that we made together with Quicksand. And that notebook is something that we wanted to make kind of as a result of these 8 years. But not a result in a complete result, more some snippets that you might like, that you can come across as you make notes. And we made a small website with that as well, called designresearchnotes.com, which is specially designed for your phone. And I'll try to switch now and then between the website and some slides that we have, but you might also just look at that on your own phone while we speak. So designresearchnotes.com. The whole idea is, what we have found over the years, it's really important when you develop design research as a new kind of strand in an institution like this, it's important to just get on with it, do it. And actually, all bits and pieces that were created during that doing are in that notebook and on that website. And I think all of you can benefit from that, but also contribute to that over time. So we'll keep adding through the design research minor stuff to designresearchnotes.com as well over time. So shall we dive in? What is design thinking through making? What it is? So first one out of about 10, I think. Thinking through making maps. So you see a map here that was made by Lucas Soutendijk in a project he did with the local water board, the Dommel. And it's actually a table as well. You don't see the legs of the table, but it's a table you can stand around. And what he is trying to do here is to map residual flows, so waste flows, basically, of this organization, to find out what you can do with it. So there's mud here, but there's also coffee residual. There's also, I think, some grass cuttings from the ditches that they cut the grass from. So all kind of stuff, and this company wanted to become more sustainable and circular. Well, it's not a company actually, it's an organization. And they started mapping with Lucas, actually, what do we have and where does it come from? So you can see here some sources for instance, the mud and where it's transported to. And actually by doing this kind of stuff, by mapping, you start to think about what is happening with all this material. And a map in that way can get many authors, in this case all the people from that organization, and they can think together what to do else with those waste streams. So that's knowledge that's being created, and also a system is created to communicate that through the maps over time.
Yeah, and might be good to mention that all of the research projects that we present to you were projects that last for about a year, some of them even 2 years, which is hardly nothing if you compare it to the PhD researchers that were involved that worked on this for 4 or 5 years. And that's sometimes pretty difficult, especially for the research associates that were involved part-time, only for a year. So they had to move fast and use their thinking through making capabilities to also, well, create impact. And that worked really well. For instance, with this project, we were asked by Osei Canon Printing Company to look at elevated printing. They, at that time, were busy with 2.5D printing, which is printing in layers. And it was a technique that was there, but actually they hardly didn't know what to do with that. So it's nice, the technology is there, but is there a market for it? And, well, who's interested in that in the first place? So Karianne Rick, who was the researcher in this project, designed a workshop methodology using the thinking through making as a means to involve a lot of architects, designers, specialists on 3D printing, and co-create, well, possible innovations. So by coming up with a sort of workshop methodology where she literally dropped a lot of samples on the table, she tried to create a lot of ideas and thoughts. And that worked really well because based on that project, Osei actually started a new business line in Japan afterwards. So, and I think it proves really well that just by making simple samples, because we didn't know either what to do with the printing, you can help companies to create new business even.
I want to show you briefly how that looks on the website as well, if I get this working. No. Yes. Where's my Firefox? No, my Firefox is on this screen. There you go. So you see here, for instance, some of the students we involved in the project at Osei Canon talking about the samples that they made themselves on that printing machine. And the website is basically built up to have some quotes, partly from the lexicon of design research that we have at the Academy. You can see some pictures here of how it's kind of used and shown to architects. There's some quotes from the books that we made, and here you have, for instance, some photographs from an exhibition that we ran, I think in 2016 at the Dutch Design Week, the graduation show, with some of the research where we made a huge timeline made out of samples, basically. So this you can also see on your phone. Thinking through making materials, and a lot more actually. This is a project of Woven Lights by Michelle Bacherman. Michelle is here as well. She was one of the first research associates that we hired, I think already in 2012, Michelle. And then Michelle kind of kept on later by building relationships with one of our partners in Japan, the Kyoto Institute of Technology, where she's been now 5 times, I think, over the past 5 summers in the hottest month, she mentioned to me. And she's worked there, actually, she came there, actually, because the silk industry really had an issue. It's a craft industry of small family businesses, generally, and they needed to renew. Because traditionally, this way of silk weaving, chiri men, if I pronounce that well, more or less, Michelle says. This kind of was mainly used for kimonos, for instance, and people don't buy so much kimonos anymore. They kind of rent them for instance, for a wedding or another occasion. So Michelle started to work with the material, and the thinking through making, she just told me half an hour ago, really helped also as an approach to talk to people whose language you don't speak. Because, of course, all the things you make is also a language, especially if you talk with other crafts people. So I wanted to show a little bit of a film that Michelle made after her first visit, or I think your Japanese collaborators maybe made it about you. So maybe about 2 minutes. Do we have sound, actually? I'm not quite sure. Let's have a look at it, because it's, I think, largely in the Japanese spoken as well. Is this sound? Yeah. Definitely. It's in.
I've been doing a lot of material experiments through a workshop that was evoking a lot of different things that we could try out. But there was also a girl who brought a piece of 3D printed material because it reminded her of weaving. And that kind of sparked my imagination because I thought, what if you literally start weaving with a 3D printer on top of textile? Can you change the structure of textile?
You're using PLA.
We wanted to include the silk that Ebara-san is making because it's such a beautiful fine quality. It's very, very, it looks very fragile, very light.
で、3Dプリンターで出来上がったものっていうのは、その文様としてのデザインとしてのものとしての意味と、あとプラスそのストラクチャーとしてそれが成り立っているというところが今回のところで、重要なところです。手作りだとその研究としてのものって行かない。それは同じものを繰り返せないということで、3Dプリンターだと同じことを繰り返して、それを研究ベースでずっとこうやっていく。
So it's only a sliver of your work, Michelle, very small part, but I wanted to show it because it really indicates, I think, something really important that we try to do in the readership for all those 8 years, which is bringing together different partners who normally would not collaborate and actually help them to do something together to collaborate better. This is one of the types of knowledge, I think, that we developed, and I think we have another example later as well, where the knowledge that we created is also about the knowledge how to collaborate with different partners. And designers can be that glue, sometimes perhaps the gaffer tape, it depends on the situation, between all those different partners. David recognizes the gaffer tape.
Might be good to mention that you're also running a summer school still with the Kyoto Institute of Technology and bring every year a group of 10 students to Japan. Got some promotion work to do here.
Yeah, we're usually a group of about 30, but all international students and a handful also from Design Academy always join.
If they're interested, they can apply later on, right? Yeah, find Michelle.
Yeah, so this work is still connected to the textile minor that has started again and where Michelle is tutoring as well. One of the ways the readership is continuing in other work. But have a look at these students. Can you explain what they are doing, Daniela?
Yeah. Anyone? Some ideas? What are they doing here?
Is any of these three here, perhaps? I don't think so. They have graduated by now, probably.
Probably, yeah. This was a project where we used experiences actually as a means to create again knowledge, and this time about elderly and mobility. The project was called Moving Stories, with the title referring to moving, literally moving, but also the sort of captivating stories that elderly bring when they have troubles in actually transporting themselves from A to B. We're looking at a lot of elderly that had difficulties in taking the bus, going to supermarkets, going to group activities. And Heather Dam, the researcher in this project, was using these experiences and tools to find out more about their stories and experiences by designing what she called an empathic suit, which was, I think it's over there, a very simple prototype. You can see it over there. The knees are banded with tape. There was something on the shoulder, so you had to bend a bit. She made even glasses, so you couldn't see very clearly. And students were asked to take the bus. And then by wearing that suit, they experienced how difficult it is to get in the bus or to get that promotion article in the supermarket. And that helped a lot to get more in the shoes, literally, of these elderly. And by doing these kind of experiences, they came up with a lot of knowledge that was very helpful for the mobility partner in this project to design different services. And I think it shows really clearly that even these kind of funny exercises can do a lot in design research. So it doesn't need to be very serious and all about academic writing. It can just be these kind of funny interventions that help a lot.
It's an example as well of when you communicate knowledge. It doesn't need to be a text or even an object. It can also be an experience. So here it's not just actually these physical restraints that are put on you. You always also would get actually a story on your ears from an older lady. I think she was 81, Betty. We'll see her later, I think. And she talks about her trip, weekly trip to the supermarket and how that actually works. So you get kind of some tasks along the way interspersed with her story. So it's a way of storytelling actually what we see here. Let's move on to this thinking through making probes. So probes is one approach, I guess, of design research that we embraced very quickly. I did myself my PhD at the Royal College of Art in the studio where the probes were originally developed, so I was quite close to the source of these cultural probes. But the idea is that you can actually design artifacts that provoke some responses from people. We did that in a neighborhood here in Eindhoven together with Alissa van Asseldonk and René Schepers in Geestenberg. Some of you might know it or even live there, I don't know. And this was together with two outside organizations again, as we always collaborate. This largest housing association here in Eindhoven, Woonbedrijf, and also the water board, the Dommel. Together, they came to us and they said, we need to find some things to make these neighborhoods in Eindhoven more sustainable in the times of climate change. Basically, we need to deal differently with water, because we know water is going to come in different ways to us, and we need to prepare our neighborhoods for that. And we want to do that together with people in those neighborhoods, make them more aware of water, for instance. So we set up a temporary studio in that neighborhood, and for, I think, 6 weeks, we also invited students to be in that neighborhood who worked with René and Alissa. And I'd like to show you kind of one of the probes they did. If I can get my cursor. Yeah. Which is called buurtwatersoep, which translates like something neighborhood water soup. Doesn't make a lot of sense, perhaps, initially. And they made a little film about that that I'd like to show. This is Alissa. Some text is in Dutch, so she's doing an intervention here. bottle.
Water in de wijk. En we realiseren ons tijdens ons onderzoek hoeveel water er eigenlijk nog stroomt terug het afvalputje in gaat.
So this is Renee talking. And she explains this lady that they're doing a project around second-hand water in the neighborhood. And she's giving this lady a bottle, asking her to catch some of the water that she normally would throw away, like washing water for vegetables or something. And then Renee will collect it later again, the bottle. Full of water, make some soup out of that water, and then she'll return the favor by returning the soup as well to this lady. They needed quite a few bottles for a big pot of soup. Collecting the bottles. They get some ingredients as well. Soup is returning to the owners. Thank you for the lovely soup. So this is just one of the provocations, which of course is about much more than just soup. It's really about trust, for instance, as well, and connections in those neighborhoods. How do people actually collaborate with the water that happens? And it's all these probes are very much, I would say, a conversation piece to get people to talk about actually what's happening around water, something that's so mundane that normally people don't know how to talk about water. Another thing they did in that neighborhood was, for instance, to have a water tasting cabinet. They collected water from different houses and then would put up stall in the middle of the neighborhood with a lot of bottles. And people could taste it, they could see the difference between the water of different houses, which seems a bit funny, but it gets people to talk about water and what it means actually in their lives and in their neighborhoods. And that led to several results which were actually implemented also by Woonbedrijf and by also the Water Board to help them actually get in touch with people to deal with these new types of water that are coming to this neighborhood. Because that is a very deep understanding, I think, with many organizations today. They need to connect to people much more. And they can't be the expert themselves anymore who's telling everybody what to do. And design research plays a crucial role in figuring out the kind of knowledge to find out how they can connect actually to people. Let's move to the knowledge circle, Daniela.
Yeah, from the off, we have been thinking through the making, about the terminology, because we talk a lot and you hear that term a lot, design research, but actually all of you will mention that you do design research, your department will mention you need to do design research, so it was actually pretty difficult to say like, yeah, we in the readership do design research, how is that different from what everyone else was doing already? And then it's important to build a vocabulary, a lexicon with terms that it becomes clear to all of us what we actually mean when we talk about empathy, or when we talk about thinking through making, or dialogues, or debates, because all these terms have different meanings to all kinds of people, and especially within a research community, it's really important to be very precise in these terms. So in order to do that, we thought we are not going to make another book, we did already quite a few, but let's use this philosophy of thinking through making also as an activity to, well, discuss the terms and make something together. So together with the heads of the bachelors and the masters, a lot of tutors were involved, as well as students, we did a lot of lexicon live sessions. sometimes at the Salone in Milan, sometimes at the Dutch Design Week, even in the Academy as well. And we try to be, try to set up these kind of dialogues in a Socratic manner, where we could all, create knowledge about these terms. That resulted in a lexicon that you can also look up, lexicondesignresearch.com, designed by Joost Kootens. That gives you a very clear overview, not only of the terms and the meaning, but also the projects that fit really well with these terms. And I think that similar approach is what we took for these publications. It's quite an empty publication. You can use it as a scrapbook. It's just a nice booklet, looks good, feels good. But there are some projects in it that might, remind you of the things we mentioned. Look up the website and see if you can find inspiration. If you're stuck in your research, if you need some tools, they're all captured in the website and in the lexicon. And by this, we actually try to support you in your process, because I think that's pretty important by, doing all these projects, creating a lot of knowledge for companies, for universities. Most important, I think, is what we were aiming for is to contribute to the Design Academy and the knowledge that's created in here, so that you as future students can also benefit from everything that was created.
Yes, so this is really done by the reader, by the two readerships, but not alone. It's actually done by the Knowledge Circle, which is also something that came out of starting design research at Design Academy Eindhoven. This is a typical thing that exists in Dutch higher education. The Knowledge Circle is basically where people who are involved in research throughout the institute come together to help promote research and to help develop a language around research in the institute. So we've been running that with some people also here in the picture. There's a bit too many to name them all at the moment who have been part of that, but you know who you are. And it's been really important, I think, in the institute to have that and do take part in the activities that are organized around that. So this is Betty. And Betty, we talked about a bit already before. She was kind of modeling for this empathy suit that we showed you earlier. That here we want to focus on thinking through making photographs, because this is work done by Maartje van Gestel, also one of the research associates, but also a tutor here at the Academy at the time. And she basically is a very strong documentary photographer, and she uses photography to actually understand situations. So she spent time with Betty to kind of understand her situation and see if she could capture her understanding in the photographs. And I think this is a beautiful example, this photograph, and how she overlaid that with some text as well, how you can put a lot of knowledge in just one photograph. So this is Betty kind of waiting to be picked up again by the mobility service after her weekly shopping at Albert Heijn at the supermarket. And she's kind of reading her ticket from the till. She's kind of waiting with her shopping there in the bag, but also here at the front in the back, in the black bag that she can actually roll. And she's dressed nicely because she's kind of prepared to meet people and to talk with them. There's a little coffee corner there where she does that every week. So it's really a whole story in just one picture. And it's a really nice example how visually you can also show actually what the knowledge is that you gained. And it goes back and forth, of course. You need to make quite a few pictures and spend time before you're able to take this picture, because you know all those elements need to be in there.
Okay, two more projects, so you know. this one is about people that suffer from dementia. And Alessia designed a game, a beautiful game, where she tried to trigger long-term memories of the people that suffer from dementia, and especially also as a way to communicate between their relatives, their beloved ones, and also their caretakers, because that's really difficult for people that have severe dementia. They can hardly, mention their needs, their sufferings, and it's difficult, especially for relatives, to start a conversation. And this game, with pictures of their past, helps them to trigger these memories, and is a really nice conversation piece, I think, that is actually used by two care institutes, correct?
Yes. So what's important here indeed is that you get to know why people behave in a certain way when they have Alzheimer and are kind of in the later stage of Alzheimer. Through the pictures, these people can still express that. And it became possible also, in several cases, to help people to have a better life in those institutes. Because their kind of resistance, for instance, to wear certain shoes became clear through these pictures combining and then talking to family members about what happened before. And they could address those kind of stresses that existed. Alessia is really strong in kind of putting in the empathy and understanding what's really happening here and how can I help people to express that. You see, these are really objects, for instance. She understood people have difficulty to just picking up flat objects or paper on a table. Can't easily be shifted around if you're that old. So she made nice objects with the glass dome that you can see the image from all sides. Thinking through making games. We made quite a few games and we played them with quite serious people. These people here are from the province of Noord-Brabant, the province we're in right now. And they actually worked with Standby on the so-called provincial water plan. That's what we do in the Netherlands. Everything around water is very much organized and discussed between everyone. So this plan is basically a plan at that time, it was I think from 2015 to 2020, about how do we deal with managing the water in that time. Again, climate change was an issue, but many partners had to kind of decide with each other how do we deal with that and how do we make this equal, actually, and fair. So Carrie-Anne, she made a game. It exists of two boards, actually, and this is the second board where you kind of can see how do the different partners relate to each other in a network. In particular, what does everybody put in and what do they get out? So on this board, you can see what how much people have put in and how much they get out. And if someone, of course, puts very much in a network but doesn't get anything out of it, that's something the other network partners should do something about. Because it means, basically, that if you lose this person, everybody loses. So what can you contribute to them that makes it valuable to them to be there? So this in this kind of real settings, we tried out a lot of the knowledge that we had and we improved it by iterating it. And actually, this game we've used in several other projects later on as well to play as a kind of new way of collaborating for this organization, because before they only kind of negotiated, and that's a very different approach, of course. I think it's time to go to India, Danielle. What do you think?
Lovely. Last but definitely not least is what we try to do is with all projects actually to do as much as possible with students. So in all projects we designed a so-called design research space where students were involved in either the making or workshop sessions. And based on all these student projects, we actually came to understand that there was huge interest from students in doing design research. So that's when the design research minor came into being. And within the minor, the third year course, we focused specifically on system design because we do think it's important, also based on all the projects we did, that you understand as a designer that you are one of many within larger systems. You can't design something just by yourself. Yeah, you can, but it will not be very impactful, especially if you design for, well, these wicked issues like Dimensia or the water boards. You have to negotiate, collaborate with a lot of stakeholders and understand the system in which you are one of many. And how to do that and how to be very meaningful and effective in that, we think is one of the strengths, let's put it that way, in the minor. And within the minor, we team up with Quicksand. You will hear a lot more about Quicksand in a minute. A really good design research agency in India, based in three locations. And why it is important to go to India is, first of all, they do things so much better than we do. And it's important for students, I think, to know that there is an entire world out there, especially here in the Design Academy. I think a lot of us reach out to the Western European network, which is good, which works really well, but there's obviously an entire world out there, and a lot of good design studios do awesome work there. And what the students learned during the field trip in India is that they can learn a lot from the Indian way of dealing with stuff, where systems are even more complex and refined. And by using their capabilities, learning from Quicksand, they actually become very much empowered to do similar kind of activities in here. And I think the video shows really well.
Yeah, we have a little film of about 3 minutes, I think, to close off, which is about kind of the experience of students in India. And those students have not been to India before, ever. So the experience was quite strong for them. Mind-boggling was one comment, or life-changing another. It happened to me as well when I first went to India. It's really a different world, but it's so nice to see kind of that it's also a world where there are people like you. And that's when you meet basically peers, people who also do design research, the people at Quicksand, that you recognize, oh, these people think very much in the same way as we do, just in a very different context. And we're very glad to give you a bit of a taste of that after this, because we think it's really important to look much more to non-Western parts of the world to help us address all the issues that the world has. The West definitely doesn't have all the answers. So let's have a look at that film, how the students themselves filmed it, and I'm giving a little commentary on it. In November 2017, 18 Design Academy Eindhoven students and their tutors visited Bangalore, India's mega city of innovation. This 10-day visit was part of the 5-month design research minor Radical Ecologies, focusing on the role of humans in systems and what makes systems human. The students worked together in small groups, comparing Dutch and Indian versions of a system of their choice, and eventually designing their own system intervention. The focus, however, was on learning to use design as a research method to create knowledge. To kick things off in Bangalore, together with our local collaborators Quicksand, an esteemed design and research agency in India, and the Mozilla Foundation, we organized a one-day design research seminar focused on systems. We recognized many similarities in the thinking behind our practices. At the same time, stark differences between our contexts became clear. The level of discussion during the event was distinctly high, which set a bar for the students, in particular for how to express doubt and political positions in their work. In the days that followed, the students set out to do design research in groups, following up on connections they had prepared in Eindhoven, and new contacts made during the seminar. Students experienced that it's very easy to connect to people in Bangalore. Strangers talk freely about their personal lives, and people in professional roles talk happily about their work. In the Netherlands, this had been notably different. As a result, the design research of every group strongly accelerated. For the final afternoon, we arranged a 2.5-hour field notes and reflection session at the Quicksand Studio with local design researchers. The students presented some of their video material and what they had learned so far. This resulted in lively discussions and praise from local peers, who thought the students had achieved a lot in just 1 week. The compliments centered on how easy they engaged with people, from important local experts to people on the streets, through simply approaching and talking, and also through interventions and probes. Students were additionally praised for their sensitivity to differences on many levels, from culture to affluence, and their ability to figure out how to deal with these differences in the context of doing design research. This study trip was a great learning experience for both students and tutors. The collaboration with Quicksand and Mozilla proved to be a very valuable exchange of perspectives and practices. Above all, we learned that design research is equally valuable in India and the Netherlands. Our successes and challenges are equally interesting in both countries. So I think with that we've brought you to India, and it's time to bring Avinash to the stage. You can already set up Avinash if you like.
You can give him a hand already. Just to,
yeah. Thank you. Connect. I'll keep talking. Okay. So, I hope you all know that this designresearchnotes.com as an addition to the notebook. The notebooks will be here also for other students. We've printed, I think, about enough for every student in the academy. So do tell your fellow students as well that they can pick one up. There's quite a few different colors, so you don't mix them up too much between you. And of course, you can personalize them as well. So I'm really happy that Avinash is here tonight, not just because I think we need to take much more non-Western perspectives, but also because there's so much connection. Actually, it's not just India and Europe. There's lots of connections between the two, which he'll talk about. Do you want my microphone?
Yes, please. Thank you, Bas. That was amazing. Thank you, Daniel. Hi, guys. My name is Avinash. I'm from India. As Bas mentioned, I'm from a studio called Quicksand. And I'm here today to speak to you a little bit about how, essentially do a deep dive into one of the projects we've been, it's an ongoing project looking at speculative design and trying to see how a process that's in a way quite conceptual and playful can be used for possibly fairly serious implications or for serious kind of consequences which could be beneficial to society at large. In the beginning, just to clarify, I think the gentleman in the beginning thought that I was an alumni from here, but the actual story is that the last time I came to this building was in 2003 as a 24-year-old student who just graduated in India, and I actually come here to see if I can do my undergrad again. But at that point at the Design Academy, I think you had to learn Dutch to do your undergrad. So I basically went back to India and I started Quicksand. So it's really nice to be back here speaking to all of you. It's a real honor, and thanks a lot for having me here. It's a real honor. So I just wanted to kick off the presentation with just literally 6 or 7 slides, just to give you a little sense about what we do, and then we can kind of take a deep dive into the project. So in a nutshell, we're an innovation consultancy, or we're a design research studio, or we're a design creative practice, as you might call us. But in most of what we do depends on meeting real people and gathering multiple perspectives, whether it's from, you know, real people who might use products and services, whether it's stakeholders and intermediaries or experts or visiting spaces and traces, like you said earlier with your team. A big part of what we also do is try to create, easy to use, easy to access knowledge assets. So in this case, what you're looking at is from a project where we try to develop personas of Indians and then their relationship with technology and health in the future. So this is a project we did about 8 years back, and it was looking at 2025. And so this was based on real research, and then obviously trying to add a layer of fiction to it in terms of future storytelling. We also envision future scenarios for these people. So in this case, the project you're looking at is with the International Rescue Committee, or the IRC, and it's a project we did in Tanzania, inside a refugee camp and looking at education for young adults. And what you're seeing are essentially scenarios for how mobile technology can be used to overcome some of the limitations that young people might find around education. And this is one of the, I think, about 25 different stories that we came up with, and just kind of one slice of it. So a lot of our work is revolving around doing real-world research, very much like Bas and Daniela kind of explained, and trying to add a layer of fiction, sometimes fantasy, and I'll get into that a little bit more as well. Finally, last but not least, we also do a lot of, what you can call convening, and we convene a lot of interdisciplinary innovation workshops. So what you're looking at right now is part of a 1-year-long project that we did looking at the future of female contraception, which for some of you who don't know, it's a topic that's actually not progressed a lot since the late 1980s or the 90s. There's not been much research or scientific innovation and investments in it. So we were contacted by a client, part of the Gates Foundation, and we were to do a workshop based on research we did. So everything you see on the walls is all research we did in India and Kenya over 4 months. And then we convened two giant workshops with about 50 experts from around the world, which included scientists, anthropologists, material scientists, and so on and so forth. And we do this a lot, of course, and it's a very integral part of research for us to know that the material we collect from the world, it's also important to see, to have other people and multiple voices see that material and to add to that material through their expertise and through their own perspectives. We also do a lot of work around building open platforms. So just to give you a sense of our studio, we're based in India, like I said. We have 4 studios, in fact, not 3, in Delhi, Bangalore, Goa, and Bombay. And we have a 5th studio in London since the last 6 months, which is only me going back and forth every month for a week. But within those studios, a big part of what we do, so we have about 50 people. Of those 50 people, only about half, I would say, or even less than half are designers in the traditional sense. The remaining, let's say 60% of people are a mix of some social scientists, some technologists, there are some managers, there are some programmers, and so on and so forth. But at the same time, a lot of our work that we do over the years, so about 90% of our work happens in the development sector, or in the social sector, as you might call it here in Europe. Which is kind of interesting because we're coming obviously from a practice where maybe, so we've been around for 15 years. In the first 5 years of our practice, we did a lot of work for corporations, for companies, for brands. But over the years, we've really moved towards the social sector, which is amazing because it lets us work on projects where our clients actually want us to spread the knowledge that we find in that project. Unlike, let's say, working for, let's say, an XYZ company where often the project you do can't be shown in a presentation like this. I can only tell you that we did it for an undisclosed client, and I can't even show you individuals. So fortunately, in the social sector, almost all the projects we work for, they want us to develop open platforms. So in this case, what you're looking at is a project with the Gates Foundation looking at urban sanitation in Indian slums. And we did this research around 6 cities, visiting slums in India, looking at the problems of sanitation, looking at the problems of space, infrastructure, culture, and so on and so forth. And we created a project, which is a website, which is for other designers and urban planners to use, which also includes ideas about the future. It includes 3D models. It includes like films and pictures to look at, and also insights to kind of base new ideas on. And finally, we also, a big part of what we do, even though we're a design practice, we actually don't do too much, let's say, physical design in a way, or tangible design. We often do prototypes, we often do pilot studies, and then we let our clients make what they want out of it. So in this case, what you're looking at is essentially prototypes for a project that's ongoing right now, looking at Ebola in Africa, and Zika in Brazil, and Nipah in Bangladesh, which are essentially 3 types of epidemics. And the idea here is to help understand and help our client understand, which is in this case the Wellcome Trust, if you know of them, is to understand what do people in India know about clinical trials? And in the context of epidemics, how can you help people understand what clinical trials are? And in a way, how can you help people participate more in clinical research in these countries around epidemics? And what you're seeing is part of a comic that we're working on right now, a comic that helps explain clinical trials to people. And at the same time, it's a research tool through which we're helping in a way, our client, which is Wellcome Trust, innovate in new programmatic ideas or innovate in the systemic design parts of health research itself. So that's my spiel. And this last slide is just a segue into what we're talking about, which is that a big part of what we do is around public engagement and to create visions of the future. In this case, what you see are comics that we build on Indian smart cities of the future. It's part of a newspaper kind of public engagement platform using newspapers as vehicles. And what you see are different aspects of smart cities of the future and trying to see how people feel about it. So just obviously, just to recap, based on what you saw, just to give you some clarity on what we do, we're a design practice, but I would say the work that we do is a mix of all of this. And it's kind of a mashup. I wouldn't say we're an ethnographic design studio. I wouldn't say we're an HCD studio. I wouldn't say we're an art and storytelling studio. It's somewhere in the middle of all of this, and also changes depending on every project. It changes depending on where we are. But I think at the heart of all of this is, I think we have a team that likes to think about the world with some sincerity, and likes to think about the people they deal with generosity and trust, like Bas mentioned, which is extremely important. And I think a lot of this is just nomenclature around a good practice. So the main part of my presentation is around a project that's ongoing called HUM 2035. Bas felt that I should go deep into one project, which could kind of give a lot more detail, and I guess that's interesting from a design point of view. And again, I think the point of showing this case study is in a way to emphasize the idea that I said in the beginning, that you can use a lot of imaginative, playful, sometimes irreverent processes and connect them to extremely important goals. And that can be quite a fulfilling process, not just for yourself, but also for clients and eventually for people themselves. So the project that we're looking at is a project that's looking at weak signals from the future. It's a project that we have been doing as a studio in collaboration with Standby and several other partners over the last maybe 8 months. And I will take you through it right now. I'm going to go a little bit fast because there's a whole lot of slides, and I think we have maybe 20 minutes? 15? 20 minutes, cool. So that'll be about 10 slides a minute maybe. Okay, so the background to this, just to set some context, is what we're trying to create is a traveling exhibit, which goes, it's a pop-up space on the future of humanitarian work in India specifically. It's a project that's looking at what are the emerging characteristics of humanitarian work in the global south. It's also a project that's looking at design fiction or speculative design, as you might want to call it. What is it? What is it for India? What is it for my studio, for myself? And is there a benefit to it? And what are the kind of embedded values inside design fiction? Now, that's the broad intention. Now, the project itself starts with some context is the fact that if most of you, does everyone here know what the Barbican Centre is in London? Yeah. Okay, so for those who don't know, it's a very popular museum and a cultural centre, been around for several decades, one of the most important places of that sort in the UK at least. And they invited us to do this pop-up, and therefore the context of what I'm showing you is to think about that. The first part of what I'm showing you is meant to be in a museum where people of all ages will consume it. So our pitch was that we wanted to make a pop-up on the future of humanitarian work. Now the question is that when you look at something like humanitarian work, it's not really a single future. It's really the future of work, it's really the future of climate change, it's the future of AI and big tech and technology, it's the future of economics, politics, and so on and so forth. So it's quite a nested, intermingled future that we're looking at. And our way of looking at any one of these, so let's say we look at the future of work. So for the future of work, in this case, we work with an academic think tank called Tandem Research, who's also located in Goa with us. And they had come up with research they'd done in India, looking at four different stories around what the future of work might be like in India. So we did a lot of research in this kind of direction. We took a direction called Fracture, which is the bottom right, which was in a nutshell looking at how a big part of work in the future in India will directly depend on the inability of public infrastructures to service its people, and therefore fracture being a term looking at a fracture in this public goods like water, for example. And water was a big part of the story. Water is one of the big crises in the world as well, but in India for sure. And along with that, we also started doing research in the humanitarian sector itself. So some of the interesting trends that we were looking at were around this kind of an example. And I don't know if you guys are familiar with this product called Plumpy Nut, which is essentially a nutrition supplement that's given in Africa. It's made by a privately owned company in the French Riviera, and it uses nuts that are from Africa, but it also supplies back this nutrition supplement in Africa as a kind of like a package. So you need to, let's say a child is extremely malnutrition, you need a supply of, let's say, 20 days, and then you kind of measure. Now, the interesting part about something like this is that often Plumpy Nut is, as you can see, the packaging, it's packaged like a consumer good, like Coca-Cola or something like that. Plumpy Nut also signs contracts inside the countries they operate in, where you, the government is not allowed to supply any other nutrition supplement in exchange for Plumpy Nut. It's also often made from peanuts, like I said, in Africa, especially in Mali, which is where we did our research, where some of Africa's most extreme malnutrition cases are there. It's also a place where these peanuts are grown. So it's kind of like an interesting kind of a topic, and an academic called Tom Scott Smith has written about the fetishism of these kind of humanitarian objects in emergencies, and that was quite an inspirational subject for us. We also looked at how brands today are working in the humanitarian sector, whether it's Tide detergents in looking at relief, whether it's looking at this kind of a lot of literature today looking at profit and purpose together, whether it's a fashion industry looking at entrepreneurship through fashion that supports the humanitarian sector in extremely obtuse manners, or it's just looking at an example like the Level Market on the top right, which is the Amazon of humanitarian aid products. So if, for example, you want to send 24 soccer footballs to a village in Africa, then you can go on the Level Market and send that to that village. So it's kind of like an strange kind of time in the humanitarian sector. And what's exactly happening, and kind of what we were trying to project through some of this research as an emerging trend, was this kind of a combination between philanthropy, government, and corporations. Now, I'm not very conversant with how it is in Netherlands, but in India and in South Asia, we've definitely noticed this kind of thing coming together. And in a way, our project therefore started becoming about exploring this as a kind of foundation for the design fiction itself. Now that kind of, in a way, obviously summarized, a lot more research was done, obviously, but this kind of some of the highlights. And using this, what we did was we tried to develop simple tools through which we could tell new stories using existing information, using emerging trends. And what you're seeing is a small sentence generator that we made on processing, which was a way to go up to people on the street or go up to students in a design school like this one and try to create new stories. So the red lines that you see are things that people can type in, and the static part is telling the story of Dash, aiming to Dash in a world where. And this was kind of a really simple story building tool. We also developed a web tool out of this for our website, through which we could really get new ideas from different kind of people, whether they're experts or design students or just the public in general. We also realized that we really needed to narrow down this project into something very finite, and so that we can have a lot more room to explore it. So what we did was this is kind of what our framing was, which was to say that we're looking at water in 2035, we're looking at creating imagery around humanitarian workers of the future, and we're looking at aggregated crises. And by that, what I mean is something that's a very, very strong trend, which is a combination of many crises. So you're looking at climate change mixed with smart city infrastructure breaking down, along with big tech taking over all your data, with the rise of hyper-capitalism, mixed with extremely new social, political, and economic conditions that affect daily life. So it's actually, and if you look around you, this is exactly where it's going. And so we kind of wanted to see what that meant for India when all this happens and then an earthquake strikes, for example. Where does that leave society? And how do you deal with the water situation inside that? So coming back to the idea that we're actually still in a museum. So the idea was that all of that stuff is great, but finally we're going to have a 6 or 7 year old kid come in. We might have an 80-year-old grandfather and a grandmother come in, and we'll have professionals come in. So we wanted to have a simple storytelling layer which could hide all of this detail, but at the same time not kind of hide it away completely. And so we tried to come up with a simple story, and the story we came up with was that it's the year 2035. The person you see in the middle sitting on the chair is a digital forensics investigator, and he's been called in to investigate a long-standing organization called HUM. 2035 is the year. And he's been called in to investigate this organization, and as he does his, carries forth his investigation, all the stuff that you see around him is the evidence that he collects. And the museum exhibition is actually all that evidence. So you kind of go through that evidence and you start peeling off the layers. Now what we did, and I'm just going to, obviously there's a lot of process work here, but just to give you a sense of all the stuff we ended up making. We started with something which was quite interesting, which was a catalog, which is their catalog. And also just to give you a sense of Hum, obviously Hum is the humanitarian sector, but in Hindi, which is the national language for India, Hum means us as the people. So this was kind of a play of words, which I guess makes more sense if you know Hindi and English, but just to help you understand that. And what we did was we made a catalog. So this catalog is made by this organization. It glorifies their own achievements. It tracks kind of all their achievements down and kind of is the starting point for this project where you can't make out something is wrong or right. We also did in parallel created a timeline from 2016. Which kind of encapsulated all our research, our emerging trends, and kind of a lot of reality and or extended reality, and then tried to fit in aspects of the storytelling. So if you zoom into the timeline in 2025, you'll see that an earthquake hits Uttarakhand, which is a place in India, and due to that earthquake, a new department gets formed by the government, which is looking at water and rationing. And along with that, because of the spread of diseases, another department gets sprung around telemedicine, which is extremely important for inaccessible areas. Now, this is kind of just a very small snapshot, but we kept building the story like this. And through that, we essentially arrived at large pockets of what the government might need to create or how an organization, like large chunks of activities that the organization might need to look at. Based on those large chunks, we hypothesized that there would be five departments of this kind of organization, and all of these looking at water, either a telemedicine, hydroponic farming, desalination, and so on and so forth. And for each of these departments, we started creating the ecology around them, the ecosystem around them, which looked at stakeholders, which looked at activities. And using that, we created a map of how this organization evolves over time. And if you zoom into this map, you will see that you will find people-based stakeholders, you will find physical objects, you will find urban spaces, and so on and so forth. And I'll get into a little bit more of these with more visuals, but this is kind of good to give you a sense of how we were kind of essentially creating the world. And I think, in a way, what you're also seeing is just, I guess, a dive into story world creation, and this is just our approach to it. Now, taking all of this, what we did was we went into a design ideation phase. We took all of this to a design school, very much like the Design Academy I know. We went to the National Institute of Design, which is the premier design school in India. Very much like all of you here. And we exposed all of this information and stories to students in brainstorming sessions, in 2 or 3 day long workshops. And they started then coming up with stories. We also had a general idea that we wanted to work with new media, we wanted to work in the game engine, we wanted to work with immersive media, and so on and so forth. So they started coming up with ideas, started creating scenes in Unity, and started to tell new stories based on the stuff that we had kind of given them. This is one part of the process. Along with that, our own team in my studio started looking at our goal, which was to create objects of the future, which was to also imagine people, humanitarian workers of the future in India. And we kind of came up with many concepts. There's a desalination ship. We came up with a concept for a water ATM based on existing kind of water ATMs that are just being introduced in India a few years back. We looked at the combination of water and medicine as a combined kind of an activity through which water could be given. And I guess a lot of you would have seen like Indian pots in villages and small towns like these ones. So here we were trying to imagine if the pot became an Internet of Thing object, and how data, like personal data, water quality, and medicinal benefits of water could all become one kind of combined entity. We also looked at people in the future, so I'll give you a few quick examples of some people that came out. So one was this persona of an urban well digger. For some of you who don't know, well digging in itself is obviously an ancient tradition, as old as civilization in a way. And in India, the practice of well digging is still actually not disappeared. I have a feeling it might have disappeared here. But it's definitely not disappeared in India, and there's also a lot of current movements in cities like Bangalore, where your students have gone, where there is activists who are looking at bringing back well digging into society. And so we wanted to extrapolate that and say well diggers have come back in 2016, and by 2035 they've been taken over by this organization. They've been given drones and kind of these robotic dogs that can go in, do water diagnostics, and so on and so forth. We looked at a relief kit assembly line worker whose job it is to assemble desalination kits inside on an assembly line. We looked at the future of a farmer, and he's now relegated to not farm on the land because it's all the groundwater is contaminated, and now he's stuck to farming inside a container. But as you can see with the branding, the Hum organization is essentially creating the containers, creating all the hydroponic systems, and also taking the produce. And so the farmer, in a way, is taken back to 200 years back when essentially he's a bonded labor inside the farm, inside the hydroponic container. We also looked at the future of a frontline health worker who, again, for some of you might not know this, but frontline health workers, who are also called ASHA workers in India, are the lifeline of health in the country. Hundreds of thousands of them work in all the states. He's the one in the green kind of dress there. And we were looking at how she would be technologically capacitated in the future with extremely sophisticated equipment. She would also be in charge of like drone deliveries and so on and so forth. So this was just a quick idea into like how we develop these people. Finally, we also looked at virtual reality. We did some really nice collaborations with another organization in the UK called HLA, and we made a film on the Philippines about a girl who's returning home after a disaster has struck, and it's a 360 film looking at her experience. We also created a film in collaboration with an American filmmaker, which is looking at a future humanitarian camp. And these were kind of small additions to this larger kind of exhibit. We also looked at these personas I just showed you and tried to convert them into 3D low poly characters for VR. We wanted to actually make a small interactive game as well. And we started kind of looking at all of these scenes, tried to make some kind of VR scenes as well, which I'll show you more of. But I think one part of it was missing. We still felt like it's all very digital, very flat. And so the idea of creating objects and speculative objects came from there. And therefore, we started exploring and making these objects that we had thought about using extremely lo-fi approaches to the prototyping, in a way also trying to think about the fact that objects made in India have a certain quality. And we were trying to think about what would a handmade IoT object look like, or what would a really roughly assembled desalination kit look like, which had to be cheap, which had to be scalable, which had to be locally manufactured, which also had to have some Chinese kind of digital parts in it with some Indian making, and so on and so forth. We also started prototyping the other smaller kind of details, like what the stuff that's made inside the hydroponic container. We started making labels for the different organizations, the relief kits. You can see there's a politician's face in there who's like the guy who's promoting all of these things. They also started making manuals. So there's the frontline health worker uses a nano diagnosis kit, for example, and that's kind of the guide around how to use it, how to use the app. We made fake apps. And finally, we put all of that at the Barbican in London in a very humble exhibit with the idea that people could experience all of these objects without trying to, like, we didn't overdo the design at all. It's very minimal, just looking at shipping crates and kind of simple displays. And all of these objects then got displayed in here. So this was kind of a project, and these were some of the collaborators. Like I said, Standby was a very important part of this with us. And the next part of what I wanted to share with you is to say that, okay, that's a great project, fine, it's fun. We did like a museum thing, so what, right? Now, internally in a studio like mine, a project like this is quite hard to do because it's not a client project. It obviously doesn't pay well because culture obviously doesn't sometimes. But it's an internal struggle for someone like me to say that this is extremely important. This is extremely important because it's very powerful. And why is it powerful? And we were actually very lucky in this case that one of the persons who visited this exhibit was the head of innovations at MSF, Doctors Without Borders, who are also actually headquartered in Amsterdam. Some of you might know, one of the main centers in Amsterdam. Now, he came there, and it was funny because he came there the first day, then he came the next day with one more person, then he came the next day with four more people. And finally, I ended up meeting him, and he was super excited, and he was excited because he said, this is exactly what we've been trying to work on. And everything you have here are the struggles and the attempts that MSF is having internally to innovate. We're looking at water. These are exactly the things we're looking at. And they felt that this was a super exciting approach. So what happened since that exhibit is that we actually got called in to do a 30 people workshop in New Delhi following this, which brought together MSF staff from 7 countries in South Asia, include and as well as England and Holland. And the idea was to look at a lot of the themes that got discussed were what NSF staff on the ground are dealing with on a daily basis, what they feel is the future. And now using their themes, we essentially built out a future for MSF using this process where the HUM project became a way to introduce them to speculative design. It became a way to help them get into activities like collaging, workshops, prototyping. Now they started making objects, and these are some of the things they made, like a really cool drone delivery service, and that's a little vaporizer that you put on your back and you can go through villages for oral vaccination. And then we develop new personas now based on what MSF felt were the future. So here we're looking at essentially, I guess what you might call a digital epidemiologist, and looking at the future of AI-based technology and epidemiology, and working in very hazardous conditions like say Ebola, for example. We also looked at a local engineer who's hacking and making new objects, and I'll show you one of the objects he's made. We looked more closely at the original forensics investigator. She became a girl now and not a guy because we felt like that's a better choice in this situation. And we also started looking at what this investigator was looking at in this world, like what are the kind of tools in the future around water that we're looking at. We also revisited the VR because we were not happy, and now we work with another artist and our scenes are looking extremely interesting. And this is this kind of looking around that VR scene. You can get a sense of the drone deliveries happening, and it's like a crowded marketplace where there's a water situation. You can see the front IoT pods, you can see the branded pods, you can see the nurse working inside. And these are now animated scenes in virtual reality with sound. We made the workplace of the investigator where she's kind of finally getting into the investigation. We also redid all the objects again with a bit more focus on trying to make them more real, We 3D printed again the IoT component. We created what the engineer is creating, which is essentially, this is a photograph of it, which is an air cooling and air purification device for urban slums that they've hacked together using some kind of like mix of technologies. We looked at again more objects. We created a new water filter. We created like a malaria kind of sampling device. We also looked at hydroponics and what all they're making and how the drone deliveries might happen. And finally, that then led to something even more amazing, which is last month in Amsterdam, not far from here, Bas, Heke, and the standby team worked with my team to host a 100 people workshop with 100 people from all over MSF for the most important meeting they have in the year. And the objective of this was to look at presenting the HUM project as well as getting into a workshop which looked at what MSF could be in 2035, and these are some of the pictures from there, some images from the workshop. So I think, and that in effect has now led to just the last part of the presentation, just looking at what we're doing right now with it. We're working to take all these experiences and to create what we're calling a speculative crisis kit, and that takes several of the tools that we've been using over the year, which are kind of all of those, as you see, with specific functions, and trying to create them into a toolkit, which hopefully will become a website and a book in the coming months. And it's also something that with MSF, we have an opportunity to see if we can essentially roll out this kit in 4 countries around the world, in Africa, Southeast Asia, and so on, and to actually use this kit in the field with real people and try to create the future of humanitarian work in reality through this project. So that's my what I wanted to share. Just a few parting thoughts just on design fiction in general, just to recap. I feel like, and something Bas said in his presentation was extremely important, that just to clarify, we've never done a speculative design project before. So this is really our first project of doing this. And I think this whole idea of the only way you will know about something is by doing it is something that really struck home based on the things I've been hearing all evening long from Bas and team. And for me, this exercise in design fiction brought out this, at least that in a way, to create these meaningful design narratives, the top is insight. So as a design research studio, we are meeting real people, meeting real experts, and we're trying to have empathy, and it's also a bit of strategy. On the bottom right are just stories, whether these stories come from people, whether these stories are things that you make up. The objective of stories is to inspire and to engage. And on the bottom left is art, and I think art is an extremely important force today and for the future, because art is one of the only mediums that's very encompassing. Art can make relationships that science can't. Art can make relationships that research sometimes can't. And I think it's really important to think of all of these together as a way to construct design fiction that can have impact and that can possibly change people's behaviors as well. And the last reflection that I have, which is very interesting that it came up from this MSF workshop, is something we actually didn't think about while we were doing this project, that in a way, it almost seems like the greatest power of this kind of process is that it creates a safe space. It creates a safe space for collaboration. And sometimes when you work in extremely complex contexts, like let's say Ebola, humanitarian crisis on top of that, political conflict, you have 2 weeks and you have to do work and get out of there, let's say. It's an extremely charged context, and to think about that even inside an organization can create fights talking about it. It can break down people talking about it, and somehow it feels like something like speculative design can create a safe space where people of different seniorities, of different professional backgrounds, can come together and think about the future in a more positive manner. That's it. Thank you. I can take any questions if you want. Is it okay?
Wow, what an amazing speech and amazing images. I guess there are a couple of questions from you guys. I would like to start with that before I start having a lovely conversation with the two of you. Are there any questions from the audience? Anyone? Yeah. It's over here, Pete. The second row. Yeah. If you shout, then it's probably, yeah. Shout anyway. Yeah, I'll translate. Yeah.
Okay, so that'll be a good question. It's very, very interesting project that you have there. My interest is more of a higher level concept. How do you get funding for projects like this, and how do you decide where that funding goes, and how is the decision made what to do and what works and what doesn't?
I can be totally transparent. So that whole project that you saw, that's £8,000. That's over 3 months. And that's ridiculously low as a budget. I'm sure you guys understand that. And it's not the kind of project my studio would ever do at that budget, right? Now, the reason I push for it, and it's kind of, in a way, me taking the lead, is that, so I guess in a project like this, you just need to take that call that is it an important, exciting project, right? And in my studio, we have something called, like a term called lighthouse projects. I guess it's not our term, but something one can use, which is just referring to projects that are not going to make any money, that are going to be a real pain to do, that are going to have a lot of opposition internally, and there's a lot of like battle for those people's time, and you're going to be putting them into this kind of fantasy project. But you still have to do them because they're lighthouses, and they're most probably pointing the way towards something that's you might not know when you're doing it, but hopefully it will reveal itself as the project goes on. So I feel like in a situation like that, you just have to have faith that what you're investing in personally and what you're taking your team into is something that will. And it's great because right now we have a great example. I mean, again, it's also a fortune, a good luck thing. I'm not sitting here saying that doing projects like this or investing is going to lead to a large global project with an extremely important organization. I don't think that happens very often, but I feel you have to believe that it'll happen. And even if it doesn't, I think the learnings from a project like this justify the time that you put into it. It doesn't matter if there's not a big project at the end of it. So I feel like that's one big part of to think about, and I feel internally, inside that, let's say you have now £8,000 and you have 3 months and you have to pull off this thing, and that £8,000 includes flight for 3 people from India to London and back, and hotels. So, yeah, of course.
So I think a good way to look at this kind of project is that the kind of beads that you add to a string to get a necklace in the end. That's what we recognize very much as a studio, as Standby as well, and I think also here at Design Academy Eindhoven, the projects we've done, it's important that you kind of start building up something, learning from it, and communicating the knowledge that you gain from it, because it will bring new projects to you, or people who recognize the value of your work like MSF in this case. And yeah, with you.
Well, are there any more questions from the audience?
I have a question. I can ask this one.
Yeah.
I sort of have two questions, I suppose. I guess I'm a firm believer of creativity and sort of research through design. But my question has to do with the, in relation to the translation of these informal knowledge. When, let's say, when these sort of informal knowledge being represented into like sort of established format, let's say academic paper or even this lecture, for example, can you talk a little bit about what is lost in the translation, maybe? Or is there a danger in translating this knowledge? And then my second question has to do with accountability. Design is always about good intention. No one's going to argue against sustainability or social inequality, for example. Can you sort of talk about, do you have a methodology that looks at sort of the accountability of design so that it doesn't get into like design for the sake of, or I guess research for the sake of research?
Okay, let's start with the first one. What's lost in translation? I would like to ask you, Eric, from Hey 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 Das. It's also a way to thank you, because he was involved in making the publications, and he helped us actually to kill a lot of darlings. Was there a lot of things you think went lost in translation?
Not sure, actually. But
well, that's a good answer.
But I do think it's a relevant question, because the translation of the research in the design, it's often a place where things get lost, also by editorial choices. So it's very relevant.
When you make these choices wisely, it's not that big an issue, is it? No, but Bas, would you like to answer that?
Yeah, I have an answer to that. I think we never really used the word translate, actually, in the work that we did. We talked much more about expressing knowledge. And actually, it's very much tied to this thinking through making. So yet knowledge only exists through the expression of the work that you do. That's the knowledge that's created in the end. So knowledge is not like an abstract entity that exists somewhere, kind of, and that nobody ever can see entirely. So the knowledge is expressed through the things that you make. So through the books that we made with Eric, it's made through presentations of this one. It's made through events that we organized during all this time that we're here, and that all together creates knowledge and is the knowledge that's actually there. So there's no knowledge actually without communicating knowledge, I would say, or without expressing it. It can't exist on itself.
And then the second question, I think you have to repeat that one. You were talking about responsibilities?
Accountabilities. Sorry.
Accountabilities. And in what sense?
Do you have sort of methodology that sort of takes in the accountability of design first?
Okay, I think that's a question for you, actually, Avanish, as well.
Yeah, we can both talk about it. Do you want to go first? I'll go first because it connects very much to my previous answer. And it's very good to ask those questions in together, actually. So the accountability, especially in academic knowledge, is very much through other people understanding what you've done and how you've done it. That's, in a broad sense, how in academia you work. So normally all the papers, for instance, that we published at conferences, they were all peer reviewed. So that means that your peers who have not been part of the research and who normally live in another part of the world, for instance in Denmark or in the US or perhaps in China or Japan, they review your paper anonymously, they don't know who did it, and they say this is solid research and we can do something with this knowledge. So process is really important, and perhaps more important than in some of the other design work that has been done or is being done here at Design Academy in Eindhoven. Although I would say, again, we very much built on the DNA of the Academy, and we've often seen, of course, in exhibitions here as well, that people do actually exhibit process, that you see all the different instances of a product that you've made and all the things that failed as well. So that is a type of transparency, showing what you've done and how you've done it, and all the things that went wrong along the way as well. This creates actually a solid foundation for the knowledge that you eventually present.
My perspective on, I guess what you, if I got you correctly around accountability, I just feel like for a lot of the projects that we do in India, also India is a very large country, so when you go into a, let's say a project and you say, I'm gonna meet 15 people, and this is gonna inform us about 1 billion people, it becomes quite a tough kind of task, and I think the accountability, the complexity of accountability itself is extremely different working in India. I mean, that's one point, but on the other hand, I also feel like, I think it's about who are you accountable to at any point in time, and in the design process, I feel like you're accountable to several people, because the design process and design in a way is looking at bridging various people and their opinions, it's looking at bridging contradictions as well. I feel it's important to think about the fact that there are actually multiple types of accountabilities that one will have to subject yourself to. There will be, I think, at one end, an accountability to your own self as a professional, as someone who's trying to advance the practice. There will be an accountability to the person that you're trying to service in the end. And I think these are both extremely important. And there will be an accountability to a client, which will be economic accountability. There will be ethical accountability if you're working, say, let's say, public health, or you're looking at ethics. And I feel like, in a way, the accountability question is looking at 8 to 10 types of accountabilities and trying to find a sweet spot between all of them and trying to be responsible towards all of them.
Anyone else? I have some burning questions. Yeah. Oh. Okay.
Thank you. Hello. I have a question about the collaborative process of this thinking design. So you said, okay, there are designers, but there are also people from social sciences that you work together. And I'm asking this because I have a background in social psychology. I'm not a designer. And my question is, because we as like social psychologists and PhDs in this kind of research, we focus so much on the result, right? So we do experiments and see if the result is significant or not. Whereas in design, you have much more value in the process, in the experience of it. So when you put all these people together in one project, how does really the collaboration work? Thank you.
I guess we both have answers. To that, I'll give an answer to you, kind of looking at the experience we had at the readership. It's not always easy because they're very different worlds, as you very well explained. But what we try to do is human-centered design. So human is in there. So we need to understand people. We need to understand everyday life, and that's the kind of social sciences is basically what you turn to. Or humanities, perhaps in a broader sense. You can also bring in philosophy, for instance. So we often turn to the humanities first as the other type of academia that we could build on, which is, for instance, different from some of the technical universities that we have here also, and that we collaborated with also, who often turn more to engineering or perhaps specifically to psychology, as in for behavior change, for instance. But we look much kind of broader to humanities as a whole. And this is a kind of a foundation for design research that exists much more, I would say, outside the Netherlands as well. It's what I was educated in at the Royal College of Art that looked much more at humanities, actually, than at engineering, largely, for the design courses there. So there's different types of scientists in academia you could work with. And I think that the one thing that really connects us and helped us collaborate is that we all focused on people, not just as individuals, but also as social groups, communities, societies, or even the world population. So people was the big thing that connected us and helped us to stay together, actually, and benefit from each other. Because maybe one thing to add, one frustration perhaps of many social sciences is their output normally is advice to policymakers. So that they're quite far away from actually making that change happen. And that's where they really benefit from working with designers, that you can actually interact with people. You don't need to go through policymakers or politicians to actually work with people.
Yeah, I'd just like to add, in a project like ours, again, there's a lot of people involved, and in most of the projects we do will have several people involved, not only the social sciences, but also biomedical sciences and so on and so forth. And I feel it's just important to understand that, A, it's just good to be aware that the same things mean different things to people. So when we go into a project on epidemics and say research, we have to also specify in a way that we don't mean biomedical research. And exactly what you're saying, social science research, empirical based research, very loose qualitative research, ethnographic research, a lot of this has similarities, but at the same time, very different expectations, very different protocols, very different aspects of success and failure. But I think, like I said earlier, I just feel like we're quite fortunate that we're in a discipline or a larger discipline where unifying contradictions and unification, I guess, or harmonizing is a running concurrent theme in design. And I feel like that's a great advantage, and one doesn't need to make those kind of distinctions, I feel, between how do you choose, how do you work with each other. I feel going back to something Bas was saying yesterday as well, it's just how do you work with people, it's trust and generosity. It has nothing to do with disciplines, and it has nothing to do with nomenclatures. And I feel like that's a really important thing. I think it also goes back to, do you believe that every person in the world can contribute meaningfully to what you're doing, whether it's a young child or an uneducated person or a doctor? If you believe that they can help you and you believe that they have something valuable to give you, then it doesn't matter if they're social scientists or not.
Burning question? Yeah? I think it's the final one, right? Yeah?
My name is Emery Sahari. I'm an architect based in Eindhoven, and I have a question for both of you. When I try to understand something, I try to think of it conceptually. So every science that we know has matured over the last, let's say, 100 years, from physics to math to psychology, all of these things. If you look at design thinking and design research, how do you see it changing going into the future, maturing especially?
That's a great question. I feel like, I guess I can speak about being in India. I've only practiced and studied in India. And I feel like for us, it's quite different, the whole practice of design in general as a discipline, because A, the modern history of design, as you might know it here, is very, very short. It literally, in a way, is seeded in the late 60s by the Eames in India with one school, and it's literally only flowered a little bit in the last 10 years. So when we started our studio in 2005, we literally had to try to do projects for free in design research to even do them, and we still couldn't do them. And so in a way, I feel like, but if you look at something like craft, if you look at the idea of making, if you look at collaborative creation, then India is one of the oldest, most diverse, vibrant histories. And so I feel like, in a way, for me personally, in India, the future of this discipline is actually to not have design be the thought leader, so to speak, in things around innovation. I feel it needs to be things around community, it needs to be things around making, it needs to be things around more kind of humanities, Indian humanities-based education, which helps people think about innovation and creativity in a more diverse manner. I feel personally that modern design is quite detrimental. A modern design thinking in a manner is quite detrimental to Indian progress in terms of industry, in terms of society. Even though I practice it, I feel like what we need as a country, and hopefully where we will arrive at, is something that connects our extremely diverse and extremely long history of things and manages to repackage that for the future for our own sake and not borrows. I mean, I'll give you a great example. If you look at my education, I studied at a fashion school. If you look at the design curriculum for, let's say, the top few design schools, they're based on the Bauhaus system. Now, is it really necessary to look at the Bauhaus for inspiration in 2020 in India? I mean, it's not necessary at all, I think. And I'm no disrespect to the Bauhaus. I totally understand and believe and have learned a lot from that. And I respect that, but it's kind of out of context. And that's primarily because in modern Indian design is very dislocated. For example, all the education I had in design school was only from books. You never had furniture. And we looked at amazing furniture and shoes by Ferragamo and things like that in books, but you never actually saw them around you. You never saw IMAX around you from, you know, in the late 90s, or any of you never saw automobiles, which are, for example, the pantheon of Western design aesthetics. You never saw those in India growing up. So for me, it's quite fake, this kind of like modern Indian design. And what I look forward to in my own studio, and what I think is really a growing trend, is to be searching for authenticity. I don't know what that is, but I think that search for authenticity will maybe lead us sometime, somewhere interesting in the future for sure.
Anything to add, Bad Boss?
That was a lovely statement. Thank you, Avi. And my thinking around this is very much in sync with that, I guess. So design research is a much younger science, if you like, maybe started in the 60s, and the original idea was maybe we can find one process that we can kind of standardize all the design in the world. They left that, I think, in the 1980s, that idea, because that clearly didn't work out. And since then, it has become more and more diverse, and more indeed being informed by the arts, by the humanities as well. So where I think that where design research sits now and what the future of design research is that we really need to move beyond human-centered design. Because human-centered design has partly brought us to the kind of problems that we have today around the climate, for instance, and about kind of all the bad things we do to the planet, but also to people, actually. I would, for a start, I think we should go toward humanity-centered design, which is a good step forward already, but then also to life-centered design. How can design actually help support life that is on the planet and help a lot of life to survive in the current situation? And there, luckily, we see that design research is being picked up by, for instance, the United Nations, who have the Sustainable Development Goals and who have actually hired designers to think about how to make these goals more actionable by actually bringing design principles to those goals as well and how you can actually apply them. So I think the future is very bright, especially because we are facing lots of very complex, wicked problems.
Okay, I think that is a perfect moment to round up. Before I give the floor to you, Pete, I just want to say a few more words. Don't worry, I will not make it very long, but I do would like to thank you both a lot. You will do that as well. But I especially would like to thank Bas for 8 lovely years working with you, but also for everything you contributed to at the Academy. I think you saw already how much we did. We had a goodbye dinner. Thank you, Design Academy, for organizing that. But I think everything you did over the past years proves that this idea of humanity and humanitarian design fits you so well that I really would like you all to stand up and give him a big hand, because he definitely deserves that.